Welcome to part 2 of GS Ghurye. Please do not forget to watch this video in continuation with the part 1. Now let us begin where we left off. We'll discuss the theory given by Ghurye on family, kinship and marriage. We'll discuss his views on the same. So he said that endogamy is the way to preserve kinship. So he said that in order to preserve the kinship, we have to get people married within the caste, within the perimeters of where you're living, okay? So that will retain endogamy and maintain and preserve kinship. He also said that kin and caste networks in India had parallel in some other societies too. He said that it was not a concept that was only prevalent in India, but it was there in other societies as well. He said that kinship and caste in India served in the past as integrative frameworks. That means it helped in integration of people. So if one girl is going to marry within her caste with someone else, it maintains relationship between the two families. So it helps as an integrative framework. He also said that the evolution of society was based on the integration of diverse racial or ethnic groups through these networks. So he said that the evolution of the society was also based on the same integration which took place because of the marriage. That marriage is endogamy. Okay. Now let's move ahead. He said that there is a very close relationship, a close link between caste and kinship. He said that because exogamy in our society is largely based on kinship, either real or imaginary. So he said that in our society, exogamy, that is marriage with outsiders, is either real or imaginary, but it is always based upon the system of kinship. And he also said that the effective unit of caste and subcaste is largely constituted of kinsmen. That means this kinship is the basis of this caste and subcaste as well. According to him, there are three types of marriage restrictions in our society, due to which the relationship between caste and kinship is formed. Now we'll see what are those three types of marriages. First is endogamy, that is marriage within the society or within the caste, that is insider marriage. Second is exogamy, that is marriage with outsiders. And third is hypergamy. Hypergamy is when a woman marries a man from a higher status. This marriage is also known as anulom viva. So we'll discuss this further in the next classes when we discuss marriage. This is just a brief introduction. Now we'll study Ghurye's views on culture and civilization. Ghurye said that civilization is the sum total of social heritage projected on the social plane. He gave emphasis on the social heritage of the society, and he said that civilization is the sum total of the heritage only. What we did in the past, we get the fruits of it today. So the civilization that we are today is the sum total of what was there in our heritage, in our history. He also came up with the term urbanization, that is a mixture of rural and urban society. Okay, so his views on culture is according to the needs and situation of the society, and this becomes independent culture, okay, which transforms, which changes according to what is required in the society today, what the situation wants. Second is accumulation and diffusion. Accumulation and diffusion is also a part of culture only. When you need to accumulate with each other and when you need to diffuse. So this the society has to take care of in order to make a civilization. He also said that metropolitan economy dominated villages by becoming manufacturing hubs. So what happened was the villages used to manufacture things in the past, but gradually, as technology became advanced, the metropolitan economy, he termed this as metropolitan economy, it dominated all the markets, all the manufacturing, and the villages were left behind. So he said that this is what culture and civilization took us to. Moving ahead, we will study his views on religion. He said that religion directs and guides men. This is a common theory given by other sociologists as well, who said that religion acts as a guide to men. Okay, it is also the center of culture and heritage. Indian sadhus, according to Ghurye, he also wrote a book on this, act as the arbiters of religious disputes, patronized learning of scriptures and the sacred lore, and even defended religion against external attacks. So he gave emphasis on sadhus because of whose learnings we could defend our religion, our culture and our heritage. All of this combined, whenever there is a patronization, sacred learning and defending our religion, all of this leads to religious consciousness. That is, we are trying to protect our religion and we give necessary justifications by the learnings that we have done in the past. So this is known as religious consciousness. That is, to defend our religion against external attacks, which the missionaries and the Oriental studies were trying to do. So Indology served as religious consciousness. Ghurye also presented his views on national unity and integration. Ghurye was a nationalist, so there has to be his views. We have to study them carefully. His views were really important. He said that the threats to unity were the linguistic minorities. That is, if we are not linguistically united, there would be a threat to our unity. And he suggested some ideas to preserve cultural unity. For example, strengthening Brahminical flow of culture. This is known as acculturation. Acculturation means strengthening the Brahminical flow. One Brahmin to another, and this flow goes on. Okay, so increasing the population of Brahmins. All the major institutions of Hindu society originated among the Brahmins because they were the higher caste, and gradually they were accepted by other sections of the community. So in this way, there was a Brahminical flow or Brahminical dominance. He said that this is how we could preserve cultural unity. These were his views, okay? So there are some other few important points which are important in the view of your examinations. Let us just quickly look at them. He did his field survey on the Mahadev Kohli's tribe of Maharashtra. The name was Mahadev Kohli's tribe and sex habits of middle class people in Maharashtra. He said that tribes could hinder nationality, which was countered by another sociologist. He was also known as the armed chair sociologist because his studies were really restricted and he did not do a lot of field survey. His views were contradictory to Oriental views. We have already discussed this in part 1 of G.S. Ghurye. And he only studied Hindu culture. So there were some restrictions in his studies. So this is what G.S. Ghurye is. We have come to the end of G.S. Ghurye's view. Now let us look at some questions. Question number 1. In a metaphorical sense, the village communities of India were of many years beyond the frontiers of dynasties which ruled the great cities. Who made this statement? This statement was given by G.S. Ghurye. Okay. So he said that the village communities were beyond because what happened was metropolitan economy took over and the villages could not develop. Because the cities and those areas, the urban areas, they developed, so villages were left behind. Moving on to the next question. Question number 2 is, who gave the term rurbanization? So this term was given by G.S. Ghurye, who said that urban plus rural society should be combined and developed, and this was known as rurbanization. So I hope this was clear to you. Thank you for watching the video.